Hello guys, welcome back to Custom Gamer. Happy New Year everybody. Hope 2013 is a very productive year for you all. Now, this concept art from Half-Life 2 may look familiar. It was released a little bit prior to the game, I think. And I think for a lot of people it just looked like a location that you really wanted to explore. It certainly was for me at least. And it certainly was for the author called Lexor, as he's decided to recreate this concept art into a fully fledged map. Well, in fact, what we've got is actually two maps, featuring the depot itself and a rather large kind of wasteland map beforehand. So let's pop into the game here. As you can see, it's a very, very faithful recreation. Visuals are fantastic. There's lots of new models and textures to really flesh out the location, make it feel unique. That while I have a lot of criticisms of this mod from a gameplay perspective, the visuals themselves are really, really nice. Some of the presentation of the visuals is lovely as well. So let's hop into the game and have a look what's going on. So this first map is really interesting to look at from a level design perspective, which is probably why this first part's about half an hour long. My apologies. But it's a really interesting case study in how to do kind of open-ended environments and how to lead the player around environments, or in some cases how not to lead the player around environments, as we'll see as we get into the map. So I like the fact that we're using the antline grubs to get health back rather than, you know, there being health kits and armor pickups all around the environment. It's kind of one of the themes of the map is that you're in the middle of nowhere in this kind of dried up seabed. Having health kits and armor pickups and everything spread all around the place would be kind of strange. The author actually does a really nice job of just making you feel like you literally are in the middle of nowhere, middle of a dried up sea. And that there's literally nothing to help you here. This depot out in the middle of nowhere, and you're just in this complete wasteland otherwise. It's a really nice feeling. The visuals really communicate this as well. You've got lots of kind of corroded metal. There's this submarine here. Reminds me a lot of Far Cry, actually. I think it was the first level of the original Far Cry where you're inside this giant rusted out. Was it a boat or a submarine? I can't quite remember. But it brings back memories of that. Again, this is mostly all kind of new models and textures that Lexor's done, I believe. I don't remember seeing this anywhere before. Yeah, I think all these new textures for the rocks and everything is all new as well. You see, there's some fairly strange kind of collision issues with some of these new meshes. This happens a couple of times throughout the map, actually. There's a, like here, can kind of walk on thin air, and it's a bit strange. And a bit later on, there's some issues where you can kind of fall through parts of the environment. It's a bit of a shame. Now, the ambient sounds and soundscapes here are quite nice. Unfortunately, there's a couple of areas where it can literally be dead quiet and there's no sounds at all, which kind of does destroy the atmosphere in this area a bit, I find. There's some really nice ambience, kind of, you know, creaky metal and all this kind of stuff, but I just wish there was kind of like a constant kind of wind blowing or sand, you know, sand brushing against this metal kind of sound. You look out across the vista and there's kind of, you know, sand blowing through it, and which makes it feel like there should be a lot of wind, and it's just not reflected in the audio at all. So we get on board the boat here. And this is kind of a section, I always have problems with these sections in maps where it's just you with your torch in the environment and there's no other sources of light or anything like that. It just feels really kind of gimmicky, especially when there's nothing really to fight. I mean, I think if I'd done this, I would have perhaps made some holes in the outer hull of the submarine, just kind of light shafts coming in, shed some light inside here. I just find these indoor pitch black sections where you just have a torch, I find them fairly tedious. There's no real gameplay to be gained from it here, it's just kind of an atmosphere thing. You can have sections like this, I just tend to prefer it when they're kind of quite short. Usually have some kind of story thing in there, a little bit of tension, but this section goes on way too long. This whole situation is exacerbated because it's really hard to work out where you've been and where you're going because everywhere looks the same. It's kind of a repeating problem I have with the gameplay on this map actually, is that for such an open-ended and exploration-worthy first map, it's incredibly hard to work out where you've been and where you need to go. There's really not a lot of hand-holding done by the author in this regard, and some people might prefer that. And while I can certainly understand that opinion, I think there's a difference between kind of giving the player the freedom to go wherever they want and not telling the player where to go at all and just leaving them confused. A really big difference there, and unfortunately this map kind of falls into that trap. We get past this submarine section, of course. Right now it's fairly linear. The main issue with this section is that, again, all the walls and floors and ceilings all look the same, so it's really hard to work out where you are. And the fact that all the texturing is so similar as well, it's really hard to kind of see kind of corners and T-junctions and things like that. It all looks like it's just one big linear path. It's really hard to see where you actually have a choice and where to go. So I've cut out a few sections of me getting horribly lost. You notice here I've just dislodged that huge pipe that I couldn't get past earlier, so I'm just going to cut back there now. It took me about 5 minutes to find my way back here. So like the sand here, again it's just another way to kind of show the player they're in a new area. I just wish the sand had perhaps been used a little bit more to kind of give areas a bit more of a unique feel. Would have made navigation a lot easier. Shame with these doors as well. Again, one of the things I like to talk about a lot is things like visuals and visual language and what the player understands in the map. So again, in this area we've got some of these metal doors you can push down with the gravity gun, others you magically cannot. Bit of a shame, but it's nice to have things like that be consistent or have some kind of visual gameplay reason why it cannot be opened. Doors. Here's the fantastic vista you get when you finish the submarine puzzle. It's a great payoff for getting out of there. And this is a fantastic climbing frame environment. You just look at it and you think, wow, can't wait to go and explore this, it's going to be so awesome. And for the most part it is. It's just a case of the actual exploring part can be fairly tedious and annoying, unfortunately. Again, this goes back to the kind of how to lead the player around an environment thing, which unfortunately this map doesn't do a great job of. We'll talk more about things like that as we get to it in the video. But yeah, fantastic visuals. If there's one thing I'd perhaps change about this area is that the shadows seem a little bit too dark. It all feeds back into the kind of navigation thing. Because even when you shine your torch on this texture, it's very, very dark. And you can't go down there. Game says no. So we'll try again, shall we? I'm not sure if there's a hurt brush trigger down there or if it's just that I've only got 19 health, so I killed myself. Either way, shame. Again, like I keep mentioning, it all ties back into kind of player navigation and leading the player around environments. It's actually very, very hard to see all the different route choices you have in this area. Again, with the brightness issues that I've already mentioned, and the fact that there's just so many places to go, you just don't know which one to pick. Also another issue with all these antlions appearing now. This is the same kind of mechanic that's used in Half-Life 2, where, you know, the whole the ground is lava part, and don't touch the floor, otherwise you get antlions in your face. This is the same kind of mechanic, only the fact that you don't really get a charge-up time on the ground, you just have to kind of walk on it and then instantly antlions, which is a shame. There's no real way to avoid them. You just have to kind of do your best to move from rock to rock. Which is a bit annoying, because you even get the kind of, you know, that rumbling effect. But the antlions just appear instantly, there's no... So it feels like you can walk on it for a few seconds, but in actual fact, you get punished straight away, which is a bit of a shame. Another thing which kind of really annoyed me about this environment is that, you know, some fighting all these antlions with my gravity gun. I mean, from the player's point of view right now, you've got a gravity gun and a crowbar. That's all you really know about. In actual fact, you have a whole slew of weapons and a rocket launcher. I just have no idea that I have all this stuff right now. And this is kind of frustrating. I mean, this environment is so large and there's so many places to go. It would have been really nice to kind of find discarded weapons and things like that as kind of, you know, a payoff for exploring. As it is now, you can explore these different areas, but there's literally nothing to find. Bit of a shame. I realise I said at the beginning that this is a wasteland, that it's nice that the authors, you know, put nothing in the environment, so it feels like it's just you and this combined depot. And I do like that, but again, at the same time, this is a game, and it would be nice to have some goodies to find. I suppose I've just contradicted myself a bit there, so I'm not quite sure which I prefer. So I mean, right now I'm just figuring that, okay, I've obviously got to explore around the environment a bit to find a way up to the depot. But again, this area is just so expansive, you're not really sure if you're going in the right direction, and more often than not, you just end up walking into a death trigger on the side of the map. But I've got to say, you can't really see where the sides of the map are. The transition from game to skybox is extremely seamless. I couldn't see it at all. So let's skip ahead. This is where I suddenly found out, oh my god, I've got weapons! Amazing! Wow, it's like Christmas. Suddenly guns. Oh, so happy. So annoying. I mean, something I say a lot in videos is, like, if you're going to give the player a whole bunch of weapons at the start of the map, just have them displayed in front of them as you start, so you know, the player can pick them up and knows exactly what he or she has got at the start of the map. The funny thing is, this map even has the perfect opportunity at the start, because you start off right next to your buggy. So you could just have all your weapons and items strewn around your buggy when you start. Or kind of strewn around that chasm area, have a little bit of gameplay to find them all. Been nice. That as it stands, hey ho. So I've actually cut quite a lot of the exploration out of this video for you guys, it would have ended up being like an hour and a half long. But yeah, the map really doesn't do a good job of kind of telling you where you need to go. As it turns out, there's just kind of one route you can take where you fall down into this cave here, like you just saw. I was saying that though, there is another way in. I'll talk more about it as I get to it. It's a fairly low blow. Yeah, these caves look really nice. Great displacement work. Again, the visuals are basically Valve quality in this map. They're absolutely fantastic to look at. There's just a lot of loose ends when it comes to the actual presentation of the visuals so the player can understand where to go and what to do. There's a lot of that coming up. Kind of the Achilles heel, I suppose, of this map. So this is why I have a problem with it being so dark in the shadows on this map. So this area probably looks familiar because we've been here before. Only this cave that I've walked out of just doesn't look like a cave at all from the outside looking in. And this is the rock I was on slightly earlier. And if you look back down into where we came from, it just looks like dark cliff. There's nothing really pulling us into that area. I mean, if there'd just been like a couple of antlion grubs in there or something to draw the player in, you would have found this place no problem. As it stands, there's just absolutely no breadcrumbs. I think breadcrumbs is the real word here. The buzzword for this map is you just needs breadcrumbs to pull the player around the environment, give them a bit of direction. Again, you've got some visual anomalies like here as well, some visual bugs you can get behind the displacements here. Just things like that. There's an area later on as well where there's kind of some missing parts to the displacements, which is it's a shame. It's not game break or anything, just jump over it, but it's a shame when the environment is so well crafted from a visuals perspective. These anomalies just stick out a whole lot more. Now we're getting a bit closer to the depot. I think by this point I was kind of frustrated. I was just thinking, I just want to get to the depot. That place looks so awesome. I've been wandering around this desert for about 45 minutes now. Game time. I think it just needs a little bit more variety in the gameplay because as it stands, it's just jump from rock to rock, avoid antlions. And that's basically all you get to do for like half an hour. Gets a little bit tedious. Some more puzzles would have been nice. So you can see that the AI does have a lot of trouble around these rocky areas. As we get further on into the environment, it becomes a hell of a lot more apparent that the AI does need a lot of tweaking on this environment. Especially the antlions, they do kind of get very, very stuck in places. So this structure's another area where breadcrumbs were not very well placed, so I just spent about 20 minutes trying to jump up here, and then I noticed that you can actually go under it. Rage ensued. Again, it's another of the things where you can't really see that you can go up there from the outside. It's just so dark. And you can hear the antlion grubs on this side. You can even see the glow from these two on the outside, but you just can't see how to get in there. Yeah, real shame. I kept on thinking that you had to like climb over the top of it or something, but I was trying to do that for ages. Just another really nice looking area. I wish this submarine had looked more like this, kind of. Perhaps a more enclosed environment, but with light rays coming through the top. Let the player be able to see a bit more. It just makes the whole environment look more interesting. Right, that's him disposed of. And I was really, really happy when we picked up the bug bait. You don't see this enough in custom maps, I think. There's some really interesting gameplay you can do with the antlions there. Provided you can get them to work right. Which again is the other main gripe I have with this pack of levels is that because the AI pathing on the terrain here is just so dodgy, it becomes a real chore just to get the antlions to do what you want. Here's another puzzle we've got to work out. Now, originally I was thinking this was kind of a pulley. I was thinking that if I pushed that kind of rail car thing out into the environment, this platform here would lower. That's not actually the case. So we have to get an antlion to land on this thing to push it down. That's where I got the hint. I wasn't actually trying to do that at all, but you can see it's really, really buggy though. I mean, it's moving up and down. The antlion's kind of half activating it. And then just trying to get the antlions to land on it at all is it turned into a real chore. So I think we'll just skip ahead to where we actually get it right. Come on, you can do it. Here we are. So in a kind of roundabout way, we achieve our goal. I mean, having the antlions being activators for puzzles like this, I think it's a really interesting idea. I think the execution of it in this map is kind of subpar because, you know, half the time you just... The precision isn't there, basically. You really need precision for puzzles like this, and either the antlion AI just isn't accurate enough, or the AI path on the level just isn't done well enough to facilitate the use of it. This is another area where I got a little bit confused for a while, and I realised I could walk across the railing on the side of the ship to proceed. Now this is where things start getting a little bit more interesting. Start deactivating these towers to proceed. Obviously now the Combine is alerted to our presence. This reminds me a lot of the entrance into Nova Prospect in Half-Life 2. It's a very similar kind of gameplay experience, using the antlions and deactivating the thumpers. Unfortunately this version has quite a few bugs in it, which we'll see. This is something I really liked, I haven't really seen before. So those are visual anomalies I was talking about. Shame. So we've got a nice seesaw puzzle here, which we can use the antlions to solve. Again, this puzzle works perfectly. It's great. It's a shame the others weren't as polished. I mean, it's simple, but it gets the point across that you can use antlions to solve puzzles in the environment. Here's where we can start seeing some pathing issues from the antlions. It's a real shame. I mean, it's one thing when the pathing doesn't work well during a kind of, you know, non-lethal puzzle, but when you actually, you know, when there is a danger of death, it becomes a little bit more of a serious issue. Luckily, Combine soldiers pose little to no threat at long range, thank God. We can kind of take them out at our leisure. I will work out how to use Half-Life 2's ladder system properly at some point in the future, I promise. It seems to change from game to game. Thank you. So this area seems a bit weird. It's like the AI doesn't want to go past the thumper, but I think if that is the case, then the thumper range is too much, because it looks like they should be able to just walk right past it here. But they won't actually attack up the ramp until you deactivate the thumper, I think. Yeah. I mean, it's hard to tell, because normally the antlions will play an animation when they're close to the thumper, you know? They'll kind of step backwards in fear. But they don't do that here, so I guess it's one of those things where is it a bug with the thumper? Is it a bug with the AI navigation? Who knows? Things are starting to heat up a bit now. One thing I really do like about the gameplay in this map is kind of the progression in difficulties you go through. So it starts off with just antlions, then the antlions become your friends, but now you're fighting antlion guards. Now you've got combine and have gunships as well. It's very cool. So this area suffers from, again, it's another issue of leading the player around and how to do it. I mean, when you look back there, it looks like it's just a dead end, right? You look back behind where the player is now. Unfortunately, the actual critical part of the map is back there. So I'm kind of bouncing around here, not quite sure where to go. It just looks like a dead end. You know, you can see the lighthouse up there, but you just have absolutely no idea how to get there. Again, it's another kind of breadcrumb issue. I'm just checking I didn't miss another area to go back here, but no. It's fairly linear progression through this area. Is another issue, kind of antlions standing in your way. I think generally if you're building an area that's designed for combat and AI NPCs, you really want to make sure that all your kind of paths are big enough to allow you to pass NPCs without too much trouble. Not big enough, I should say wide enough. You can go around here and go up to the lighthouse. Unfortunately, it's just not signposted well enough. I mean, when you're in a combat scenario, generally the player's attention is on the gunship that's trying to kill him, not exploring around the side of a tiny cliff to find the way forwards. I think it just needs something on that cliff to kind of make the player look over there like, ooh, look, what's over there? Right now it just kind of hooks out onto the seabed. There's nothing really catching the player's attention. So there's a nice kind of new gameplay device here. You've got like a combine ammo dispenser. Teleports new ammo and health in here. It's a nice setup. It's kind of a shame, really. I mean, that ammo dispenser is just a perfect way to show player kind of how things work. I mean, it's very visual. You can see the kind of ammo and health icons on the screen. You press the button and a new one teleports in. It's very easy to understand. It's just a shame that the author hadn't, you know, displayed that same kind of logic in their map design. The other issue here, which you'll notice once I've finished this fight, is that the gunship kind of shoots away parts of the lighthouse here as you fight it. But it's never really shown to the player in a very good way. I mean, it could be happening right now while I'm inside, but there's no real kind of, you don't get a screen shake and a big explosion sound or anything like that. It just feels like parts of the lighthouse just kind of disappear as you fight. You never really see it happen. As you'll see, it kills me in the end because I wasn't aware that the environment had changed. There you go, you see part of it disappeared there, but there's no real, you know, there's no explosion, there's no kind of feedback to the player like, oh shit, you should check out what's just happened. Which is not communicated well enough. There we go, and dead. Yeah, it's a shame. Look where the autosave puts you. Oh my goodness. No, no, no. Put an autosave at the beginning of the lighthouse, please. Alright, we'll be back in part two, where things get a lot better. And I'll see you guys soon.